Mr. Benny Greb.
Hi.
Hi there, folks. I'm Martin from Thomann, and I have a great guest here, the fabulous drummer, Mr. Benny Greb.
Hi.
You are one of the lucky drummers that has an own signature stick from Big Firth.
Yes. I designed a stick 12 years ago. That was my first attempt. Back then I thought, I have to make a trade-off, basically. I have to, in order to have a stick that has a nice rim click sound, that feels substantial in my hand, and has a certain weight to it, and also a certain diameter. I always was a 5B range kind of guy. So I thought, if I like that 5B feel and that weight, the trade-off has to be that it's a little bit top-heavy. If you look at the most 5Bs on the market, they are a little bit like on the top-heavy side. So, and then sometimes in the last couple of years, I gravitated towards sometimes sticks where I was like, oh wow, they bounce a little bit more, they just come back quicker. They make it a little bit easier, so to speak, but without losing the sound. So the second thing I thought was, gee, it would be nice to have a tip that is a little bit smaller, that doesn't like excite the whole cymbal immediately. So when I play the cymbal, it's not zzz, but it's ding. Mm-hmm. And we sometimes like to have the ding,
yes.
And sometimes the zzz when you hit the edge, so you can control that a little bit better. Yeah. Sticks are incredibly important. And one of the main things is sound. When you go to a music store, and you usually see people trying out sticks like this. And then they, oh yeah, oh yeah. So they usually take the one that like it lets them play fastest and stuff. But what I would also recommend is to, that rim click sound is accurate and nice, and that it sounds nice on a cymbal, that's super, super important. And that it allows you to play quiet, so you have the finesse and stuff. It's a huge part of your sound. So this is very important. Don't forget about that. It's great to play fast, it's amazing. But it has to sound good, ultimately. The other thing is, and this is a stupid, it looks silly, but this is a good test, do this. Mm-hmm. Just hit your head lightly,
or the head of your bass player.
No, but hit your head lightly, and then you can hear whether the pitch is the same, right? Yeah. This is a great test in the music store, or like when you take out a couple of, because when the pitch is the same, they will sound the same on other more beautiful surfaces. We'll be right back.
as you all know, drummers are not using sticks, but brushes as well. And in the case of brushes, Benny is using two models, a purple one and a black one. And it's a great thing about the black ones, because I need to give him two. And he is explaining now why.
First of, this is a little bit decadent. It's not a tip that I would give you now, because I would feel uncomfortable. But if you want to know what I do, I tell you what I do. So first of all, this is the RMWB. This is the Russ Miller signature brushes from Rick Firth. And Russ's idea was that you have a different stick, because you have two different rolls of two different brushes when you play the brushes sometimes. So the right hand goes to the right cymbal, you have a sweep brush, and you have a more like rhythmical brush, and one more for the sweep sound. So he came up with this idea to have two different densities, so to speak. Like, one is a little bit more stiff, the other one is a little bit less, but they're both on the stiffer side. So the normal ones are the, you have them too,
you have,
right?
The heritage brushes?
Yeah. So these are, I would say, if you start out with brushes and you want to get into it, I'll do it now for you. It's also a little bit decadent here, but what I do, I learned this from a couple of brush guys, is you put it not all the way out, but like this, and then you bent it, mm-hmm. so it's like this, so it can fit in your hand like that. So, and also, you make sure that if you have your kind of spread like you want it, that it won't ever like be further out than that. So you basically say like, okay, this is my preferred, and then you're done. These are really nice. They are very flexible. They have a very smooth, very nice, like silky sound. Now, if you want a little bit more, yeah, I wouldn't say aggressive, but a little bit more like clear, more almost shaped. Compressed yeah. sound, here's what I do. I take, you will see with the Russ Miller brushes, you have an HD sweep and you have an HD ride. I take the sweep out of every pair and I use those. Let's hear the difference in sound. So two, three in time and go. So these are just a little bit softer, a little bit nicer, maybe more like for traditional jazz, for ballads and stuff. And this is maybe more for your... You can really play very percussive with mm-hmm. them. What I also love to do is to use it like... to really use them as a shaker-like effect. So this is what I do. I mean, they work as a pair nicely too, but yeah, this is my little decadent trick that I do.
Then there is a third component of the drum set where you can use sticks. And I have one here. It's the brand new Wick First Kick Beater number 5. You have two of them right here. And yeah, it's wooden. I've never seen a wooden kick beater, so what is special about the wooden kick beater?
I think that was the idea behind it. It's such a beautiful thingy. Drummer legend Peter Erskine had the idea for this. So he came up with, like, why can't we shape the wood? We might be able to balance it a little bit differently by getting different shapes and stuff. And also, I really liked the other kick beaters by Vic Firth. There is a wooden one, there is one with felt, but they were also, for me, like a little bit on the heavy side. Many drummers like that, but there is also a place for, like, beaters that feel weightless, almost, in a sense. And I really like that. If you are on the side of, like, oh, geez, like, I almost feel like the slingshot effect of, like, ooh, I have to really move something, and I don't like that, maybe this would be something for you. And it has a very, very specific sound.
Okay.
Like, another thing I wanted to share with you, and people sometimes forget about that, these. This and the drum stool are my most important tuning devices. I use that for tuning. I have a whole drum camp about only, like, sound and tuning and stuff. And this thing sometimes turns people that say, like, oh, I find tuning difficult and I can't hear the differences in pitches, like, turns them into, like, huh, and then they. Bottom line is, I think it's, I always have them in my stick bag. They usually never wear out really much because I use them when I set up, when I change drum heads, and I go around and hear the pitches of the different tuning lugs. This particular one is the American Custom T2 Cartwheel. I like it because it's not too hard, it's not too soft. You still hear like an attack, but it's this that makes it easier to hear if you have a gunk, if you really have an attack. It confuses the ear sometimes. Maybe this helps you too. Try it out. Maybe you can hear the pitches a little bit better when tuning.
One last thing we have. Vic Firth got new headphones.
This is maybe the most closed headphone on the market that you can get. Although it's not made for, like, being like a super studio headphone and stuff. I had to lend this to producers and to sound engineers because they just can't be in the same room and check the signals. While having this on, because it's so nicely isolated. Even in the same room like the drums, you can get an idea of what the microphone sounds like. And like I said, I use it at home, like, to get playbacks in my head and to just protect my ears at the same time.
Do you have any other questions regarding drum stuff and drum content, etc., or any suggestions of artists, drummers we should invite? Can leave it in the comments. Thanks, Benny, for being here.
Big pleasure.
It was a big pleasure for me as well. And thank you guys for tuning in, and see you soon.